The prisoner designated the worst of the worst is rudely awakened at 4 a.m. and is told that he's being shipped out of the prison where he currently resides. This man had no idea this was coming, and he is, to say the least, a little bit annoyed. He's not going anywhere close by either, so that means he'll be taking a trip on America's most notorious airline, Con Air. The prisoner won't be the only one taking the trip. In fact, he's going to be flying with some of the country's most dangerous criminals. We're talking about murderous gangsters, prolific drug dealers, killers, criminal psychopaths, extortionists, and kidnappers. Unfortunately, Nicolas Cage won't be taking the flight, and so you might wonder how authorities managed to control a plane full of such dangerous men. Keep watching, and all will be explained. We'll start with some of the formal details and later get around to what could possibly go wrong when you're transporting a bunch of violent and sometimes ingenious criminals. First of all, it's not actually called Con Air. The real name is the Justice Prisoner and Alien Transportation System, or JPATS. We probably shouldn't have to tell you this, but the word alien in this sense doesn't mean a large-headed green guy from another galaxy, it's just someone who's illegally living in the USA. Those people also sometimes get to fly on Con Air. It's a busy airline, too, with three planes moving something like 260,000 criminals and aliens each year. You might wonder why they need to be moved, and there are many reasons. Some people might be flying back to the country where they come from because they're staying in the US illegally, while others are getting extradited if they're wanted men and women in another country. On other occasions, such as the made-up guy we talked about in the intro, a prisoner might just have a court date in a far-off city, or he might be being moved to a different prison. Quite a few of the prisoners have just caused too much trouble in one prison, and so they have to be flown somewhere else. These guys are obviously the passengers that pose the biggest threat. Con Air is actually fairly new, but that doesn't mean criminals didn't fly in the past. It just means that in 1995, the Marshals Service Air Fleet linked up with the Immigration and Naturalization Service and said, let's make one multi-purpose airline for wrongdoers. Right now, they have three Boeing 737s, a smaller Saab 2000 turboprop, and some corporate-sized jets. JPATS has its base in Kansas City, Missouri, and it's there where prisoners are allocated a plane after a judge, a defense attorney, or a magistrate has said someone needs to be moved. The director at the headquarters said to think of this office as a kind of travel agency, only they aren't sending people on vacation, but to another prison or another country. We hate to tell you this, but the planes don't look like the one in the ridiculous but amusing movie Con Air. Yeah, there are no cages for the most dangerous criminals on the real Con Air. In fact, the planes don't look different from the passenger planes most of you have traveled on. They're just run-of-the-mill jets. What the movie gets right is the fact that some of the USA's most dangerous people have flown on those planes. If someone is deemed really special, such as a drug lord like the notorious Joaquin El Chapo Guzman, then they'll take one of the smaller planes. That's not to say we exaggerated at the start, in that sometimes Con Air will indeed be occupied by some very dangerous people. That's why the inmates that are moved are given no warning about the operation. As we described in the intro, guards will come into their cell when most of the other inmates are sleeping and just whisk the person away. There's no chance to say goodbye to other inmates or for friends to wish them a safe flight. The public doesn't get to know either, and that's because the authorities don't want the operation being sabotaged or for a disgruntled member of the public to attack the prisoner. You get the picture. It's a very secret affair. If the vehicle is just an ordinary passenger plane, you're probably thinking that it could be a bit dangerous having a load of killers and other criminals in the air all at once. You might also be surprised to hear that the seats are just regular plane seats, and that the prisoners are not placed in them behind some kind of safety contraption that you might find on an amusement park ride. The only thing they can't do is unbuckle their seatbelt when the sign comes on to say it's safe to do so. The reason the prisoners aren't locked into the seat is because they'll be wearing handcuffs, ankle chains, and waist chains. But what if one or more of the prisoners are deemed extremely dangerous or very clever when it comes to escape? Okay, let's imagine the fictional cannibal Hannibal Lecter had to take a trip on Con Air. Well, in this case, he'd probably have to don a pair of mittens that would ensure his hands couldn't be moved at all. On top of that, the handcuff keyholes would be covered, and because the man is good with his teeth, he'd also have to wear a mask. Houdini wouldn't be able to get out of that, and besides, there are armed marshals on the plane, too. Another matter is the seating arrangement. Some of you will know that it can be a nightmare when the person next to you is a snorer or keeps falling asleep on your shoulder. On Con Air, the worst kind of nightmare is when you have two people next to each other that are mortal enemies. That's why the authorities make sure that the two rival gang members won't be sitting in seats 22A and 22B. But if that were the case, there'd be a lot of headbutting going on, or at least some rather colorful language being spat at each other. One prisoner who actually flown on Con Air said the Bureau of Prisons takes into account at the airport who the gangbangers are. People, he said, were on the frequent flyer program. He said the most dangerous people will be placed far from the women, but since he wasn't dangerous, he got to sit just in front of them, something he enjoyed since he'd been deprived of seeing women close up for some years. It might not come as a surprise to you that some criminals come from poor backgrounds and have never flown before. This is what a prisoner said about a guy who'd never flown. The two were sat next to each other. "Next to me, a young black kid looked like he was going to pass out the instant the plane surged forward for takeoff. He'd never flown before and he had no idea what to expect. His fingernails were dug into the plastic of the seat for the entire trip." The other guy said he didn't mind the trip at all, and even in handcuffs and other restraints, he said he felt pretty comfortable, as comfortable as he'd ever felt flying in coach. Jokingly, he said that it was quite an indictment on the airline industry. That same prisoner said the funniest incident was when the plane stopped to pick up one prisoner who boarded wearing prison black and white stripes. Most of the other prisoners were wearing the orange uniform, which he said made this guy look like a zebra among lions. "Well, there are a lot of marshals on board too, so there's a mix of colors. The rule is for every 200 passengers there must be 12 marshals, and all those marshals have to know something about emergency procedures just as flight attendants do. So what's it like, a trip on Conair?" Well, one man who had made the trip said it was the worst plane ride I'd ever experienced. It was worse than I could have imagined. He said he had no idea where he was going, and all the time he was surrounded by marshals with shotguns. He was told where to sit, with the males sitting at the back and in the middle, and the female passengers getting the front seats. Statistically, the most dangerous place to be in a crash. That's some infographics info, not what the guy said. He said before getting on the plane, he was patted down, which wasn't so bad, but when he needed to pee, he had to do it in front of one of the marshals. The guy said one of the worst things was all the waiting around, because the plane made a few stops and paperwork had to be done at each stop. He eventually got off at the third stop, which was Oklahoma. Another nugget of information for you is the fact that Oklahoma has the highest incarceration rate per capita than anywhere on planet Earth. Okay, so back to the man's story. Well, that's it, really. He just said it was a long and exhausting trip, and peeing and pooping was rather a humiliating experience, far from what one might expect when traveling first class. We mention first class because what might surprise is flying Conair is really, really expensive. You'd think for the cost of the flight, the prisoners would get served caviar and Dom Perignon champagne. We found that in 2017, 849 inmates were flown from Hawaii to Arizona, but on separate trips. The cost in total was $1.3 million, which works out to be about $1,540 per flight per person. That's certainly a first-class price, because if you were to book a trip in economy today, you'd get that for about $200. The reason for the added cost is, of course, all the security. On this particular trip, the inmates at least got a meal, but that can't have been too easy to eat wearing handcuffs. There are no movies on the flight, and the tickets, of course, are always one way, with the destination being federal prison. The most expensive Conair flight we could find was in the state of Washington, which, when returning two probation violators to Florida in 2014, paid a whopping $34,000. They used a small state-owned plane called a King Air, which the governor usually travels on, but in some cases it carries very dangerous men or mentally ill inmates. We found another case when one of America's most notorious criminals was taken to prison by private jet. His name was Gary Ridgway, aka the Green River Killer, and his trip from Colorado to Washington cost $10,761. You might now be thinking, well, if you're American at least, why are my taxes going toward these very expensive flights? Why not just put these guys on a secured Greyhound like the rest of us who can't afford expensive flights? The reason is security. It's safer to get the prisoners to their destination as fast as possible, and let's face it, there aren't many places to run if you manage to break out of a moving plane at 35,000 feet. You've also got to take into account that driving from one distant state to another means lots of meals and lodging beside the security risks. So the costs can add up when traveling that way. Another matter is moving prisoners long distances on the road has caused numerous deaths and injuries. In 2012, a man named Michael Dyke spent 3 days shackled in an Inmate Services Corporation van. He was already quite sick with diabetes, and he complained that his shackles were making his condition worse, and also complained that his insulin needed to be kept cold, not hot. The stuff was actually kept on the dashboard of the van. Because of what happened to him, both his legs had to be amputated. So maybe Conair really is a better way to move around from prison to prison. Some marshals even said the prisoners love the view from the air, given that four walls is what they regularly get to see. Now, we'd love to give you a Conair the movie story, but it seems the inmates are so restrained mayhem just doesn't happen. This is what an LA Times report said about the criminal passengers. The inmates are docile. Some nap, some stare out the windows at the open spaces below. The only Hollywood moment we could find happened in the 1980s, when three prison gang leaders were being transported on a plane whose engines burst into flames above Nebraska. The pilots managed to land the plane and the inmates were sent straight to the local jail. That was prior to JPATS, though. We can find no instances of JPATS planes crashing like in the movie, but we know that if a commercial aircraft carrying a handcuffed prisoner was in trouble, then if the situation was bad enough, we guess the marshal would have to remove the prisoner's cuffs. We had to go through a 118-page document to find the only major JPATS incident, and that happened in 2003 when a plane's tire burst on landing. It didn't say if the men were removed from their restraints and only says that they were evacuated from the plane. In the year the report was written, there were 11 incidents with passengers in midair. We guess the incidents in these cases meant air rage. That same year, there were 23 medical issues of prisoners, but nowhere in the document could we find what the protocol would be if something serious happened and the restraints might have to be removed. The document also says sensitive information redacted a lot, so we can't really tell you if the mayhem of the movie Con Air could happen in real life. We'll hazard a guess and say that if a plane went down and prisoners died after not being helped out of their restraints, the authorities would have a lot to answer for. Most countries have their version of a Con Air, and they're not all alike. It was reported in the UK in 2012 that the cost of sending Polish criminals and fugitives back to Poland from the UK cost about $65 million a year, but that included holding the criminals first and then processing them. One flight didn't look anywhere as near as comfortable as the US's Con Air. The criminals were just handcuffed, but it should be said that most of the people were accused of only minor crimes. There was also one cop for every passenger. It seems US Con Air is certainly hardcore, but it's at least comfortable. We'll stick with the skies for our next topic and this mind-blowing story: how a 1-in-a-billion chance brought down a whole airplane. Or if that's not to your liking, have a look at this video. Whichever you pick, click now.